Hi, this is Dr. A with your Digestive System Anatomy and Physiology review. So let's start with the function of the digestive system. The function is the mechanical and chemical digestion of food and then the absorption of the nutrient molecules that come from the digestion of food and then the elimination of solid waste that were not food or were not at least nutrients that we needed. The organs of the gastrointestinal tract are the mouth, oral cavity, salivary glands, the pharynx, the esophagus, the stomach, liver, pancreas, and gallbladder, the small intestine, the colon or large intestine, and the anus. The accessory organs are the pancreas, liver, gallbladder, and salivary glands, and we're going to address what they do, but they are considered accessory organs because food does not go through those organs, but those organs do contribute to the digestive process. The digestive system is also known as the GI system or gastrointestinal system. It includes approximately 30 feet of a continuous muscular tube. This tube is called the gut, but also the alimentary canal or the gastrointestinal tract. Most digestive organs are actually distinct sections of the gut tube. So, for example, you would have the skinnier section of the esophagus and then that balloons up into the larger stomach. It's actually just part of this continuous tube. These organs include the following that are part of the muscle tube, the gut tube. So we have the oral cavity, which is the opening of the tube, then the pharynx, which is the throat, the esophagus that leads down to the stomach, which leads to the small intestine, which leads to the large intestine, and then the exit of the large intestine is the anus. The accessory organs are involved in the digestive process by the fluids that they secrete, but they are not part of the continuous gut tube. And these organs are connected to the gut by ducts, and ducts, if you will, are like mini tubes that can put their secretions into the GI tract. The salivary tract, the pancreas, the liver, and the gallbladder are all the accessory organs of the gastrointestinal system. So there are three main functions to the digestive system. The digestion is a primary one, and it's the physical and chemical breakdown of food into smaller nutrient molecules. So physical has to do with you chewing your food in your mouth, and we're physically breaking the food down. And then the chemical breakdown has to do with the acidity of the stomach and the enzymes that help break that food down. And we break it down so into smaller molecules so that the molecules then can be absorbed. So that's the second function, is the absorption, and that's the process by which the nutrients will pass into the bloodstream. So it has to be small enough to be able to leave the gut tube, the GI tract, and enter into the capillaries that surround the GI tract. And then the elimination is the expulsion of any food that is not digested or absorbed. All right, let's start with the oral cavity, the beginning of digestion. So it is the first portion of the continuous gut tube. You have in the oral cavity, you have teeth that mechanically break up food. The tongue moves the food around and mixes it with saliva. The saliva does contain some digestive enzymes, and those can start breaking down, especially carbs. So the digestive enzyme that saliva contains is salivary amylase. And that's why sometimes things that are starchy will taste sweet in your mouth, is because amylase is already breaking down that starch into sugar. And the saliva also lubricates food. It has a little bit of mucus in it, so that makes it easier for you to swallow your food. The taste buds on your tongue will detect the five main flavors, so like salty, sour, sweet, bitter, and umami, which is savory. The palate is the roof of the oral cavity. Right here, the bony anterior portion is the hard palate. The flexible portion at the back is the soft palate, and the uvula hangs from the soft palate, where it is involved in speech production and in the gag reflex. The cheeks are the lateral walls of the oral cavity. The lips are the anterior opening, and the entire cavity is lined with mucous membrane, and a portion of this membrane forms the gums or gingiva. The teeth in the front of the mouth bite, tear, and cut food. They are incisors and cuspids, and the teeth towards the back of the mouth grind and crush food into finer pieces. They are the bicuspids or premolars and the molars. All teeth consist of two main parts, the crown that lies above the gum line, which is a part of the teeth that you see, and the root that lies below the gum line, which is a part of the tooth that anchors it into the bone. And the root is anchored into the jawbone by cementum and periodontal ligaments. The crown is covered by hard enamel, and the bulk of the tooth is made of dentin. The hollow interior is a pulp cavity, and the crown and the root canal is the root. Humans have two sets of teeth. The 20 deciduous or baby teeth, they erupt or come out when between the ages of 6 months and 28 months. The babies start getting all their little teeth. Around age 6, the deciduous teeth will begin to be replaced by the 32 permanent teeth, which are the adult teeth. And eruptions of the permanent teeth will continue until around ages 18 to 20, which is when you get your last molars or your wisdom teeth. All right, let's move on to the pharynx, which is the throat. So after the oral cavity, the next portion of the digestive tract is a pharynx, or the throat. The food first passes through the oropharynx, which is kind of level with the mouth. Then progresses through the laryngopharynx, and that is, kind of like the back of the throat. Obviously, you don't want to go down into the larynx because that's the voice box and that's where air is supposed to go. So there's an epiglottis, which is a flap that prevents the swallowed food from entering the respiratory tract through the larynx. The esophagus is a muscular tube that is about 10 inches long in most adults. It connects the pharynx to the stomach, and it carries that food through the thoracic cavity, so past your lungs, etc., and into the abdominal cavity. And that's where it enters into the stomach. Food is propelled through the esophagus and the entire GI tract by wave-like contractions called peristalsis. The movement of peristalsis reminds me, if you will, of trying to squeeze a tube of toothpaste, right? It squeezes and moves forward and it lets go. That's kind of an illustration of peristalsis. So next, the food enters the stomach, which is a J-shaped muscular organ. It churns food with hydrochloric acid, which is very acidic, and other gastric juices to form chyme. The stomach consists of three parts. We have the fundus, which is the upper portion, the body, which is the main portion, and the antrum, which is the lower portion, which then will connect into the pyloric canal and into the small intestine. There are folds called rugae that line the entire stomach. And these allow the stomach to be distendable or to be able to hold a lot of food. There are two muscular valves that are called sphincters that control the flow of food through the stomach. So they open and close, right? That's what sphincters do. So the cardiac sphincter allows food to pass from the esophagus to the fundus, and the pyloric sphincter regulates the passage of the chyme from the antrum into the small intestine. Next, we move into the small intestine. The small intestine is the longest part of the gut tube. It extends from the pyloric sphincter to the colon. It is the major site of digestion and absorption of the nutrients. So this is where all the magic happens. It's in the small intestines. There are projections that are called villi, and they're finger-like projections. And they make the lining highly efficient at absorption. So they increase the surface area of the lining. And the surface area of the small intestine is about as large as a tennis court, which is quite amazing when you think about it. The villi then also have microvilli that are on the surface of the individual cells that line the villi, and that further increases the absorptive ability. So you have finger-like projections that have cells that have finger-like projections on them also. The small intestine has three sections. The duodenum is 10 to 12 inches long, and it begins at the pyloric sphincter. It kind of has a C shape, and this is where the pancreas and the gallbladder add their secretions. The jejunum then follows, and it's 8 feet long and extends from the duodenum to the ileum. And then the ileum is 12 feet long and connects to the colon via the ileocecal valve. Then we have the large intestine. From the small intestine, any remaining fluid enters the large intestine. And any remaining food, anything that has not been digested, enters the large intestine. Most of this fluid is reabsorbed in the large intestine. You have to have a right balance. If you're chronically dehydrated and too much is reabsorbed, then you're going to have constipation and really hard, dry poops, which is not good for you. The remaining material is solid waste, also called feces or stool or poop, just like I said. Feces are evacuated from the body via bowel movements. And the large intestine is about 5 feet long. It begins at the ileocecal valve and ends at anus. The large intestine is also where all your little gut flora lives. And these little bacteria can help finish breaking down your food. They produce a lot of compounds that are really helpful to your health. And so basically they eat what you haven't eaten, but they are part of feces also. The cecum is a sac-like area in the first 2 to 3 inches of the large intestine, so close to where it connects to the small intestine. And the appendix, which is vermiform or worm-like form, so it just kind of hangs down, right? It's located at the end of the cecum, and it's part of your immune system. The colon consists of 4 regions. The ascending colon extends upward on the right side of the abdomen. The transverse colon travels in horizontally across the upper abdomen. The descending colon travels down on the left side of the abdomen. And then the sigmoid colon curves in an S shape to the midline of the body. The next portion of the large intestine then is the rectum, which stores feces. And the rectum leads to the anal canal, which then ends at the anal sphincter. Another sphincter muscle again opens and closes, like all sphincter muscles. And the anal sphincter is the external opening of the digestive tract, and it consists of rings of muscles that control the process of defecation or pooping. So here's an illustration of all the components of the digestive system. So we have the mouth and the salivary glands here, the pharynx, which is the throat, the esophagus, which leads through the thoracic cavity into the stomach. Right here is the stomach, a larger pouch. The stomach leads into the small intestines here, duodenum, ileum, and jejunum. And then we have the large intestines. So we have the cecum here with the appendix. And we go ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon, and then rectum and anus. So the accessory organs are the pancreas, the liver, and the gallbladder. And they all add their secretions into duodenum section of the small intestine. So let's talk a little bit about these accessory organs. So they are not part of the continuous gut tube. They produce substances that are needed for the chemical breakdown of food. It includes the salivary glands, which produce saliva with salivary amylase, the liver, which produces bile, which helps break down fat, and the gallbladder that stores the bile and helps release it. And then the pancreas, which releases a lot of the digestive enzymes that helps break down the proteins, the carbs, and the fats that are part of the food that we eat. So the salivary glands produce saliva. Saliva mixes with chewed food that form a bolus that is easier to swallow. The saliva also contains amylase, which is an enzyme that begins to break down of carbohydrates. So carbohydrates are starchy foods. There are 3 pairs of salivary glands. You have your parotid glands that are in front of the ears. They're the ones that kind of, you can feel the sour in this area. The sublingual glands are in the floor of the mouth here and inside there. And then the submandibular glands are also in the floor of the mouth. The liver is located in the right upper quadrant of the abdomen. It has many functions, but processing the absorbed nutrients is a main one. It also detoxifies harmful substances and produces bile. Bile is part waste product from detoxification and part bile acids, which help in the digestive process. And the liver is the main nutrient, like I would say, factory distribution center. So once the food, the nutrients have been absorbed in the small intestine, they enter the liver via the portal circulation, and then the liver kind of decides what goes where and what we're doing with the different resources. So bile assists in emulsification, which is breaking down of large fat molecules into smaller droplets. It works a lot like dish soap to clean greasy dishes. So if you put, the reason we use soap is soap can break down large chunks of oil and grease into smaller ones that can easily be rinsed off and go down the drain. And so bile does that so that the large fat droplets become smaller fat droplets, which are then more accessible for the enzymes to break down and release the fats that are in there. The gallbladder lies under the liver and it stores bile, and the bile reaches the gallbladder by the way of the hepatic and cystic ducts. And contraction of that gallbladder sends the bile back down the cystic duct and into the common bile duct, where it joins with the pancreatic duct. And the bile then enters the duodenum, where it emulsifies the fat that is in the chyme. The pancreas then connects the duodenum via the pancreatic duct. It produces two key digestive secretions. It buffers, it produces buffers that neutralize the acids in the chyme, and it's like a bicarbonate buffer. So, you know, we said the stomach's really acidic, it has hydrochloric acid, pH is maybe like 2 in the stomach, and the small intestine needs a neutral pH for all of these digestive enzymes to work. So the pancreas produces an alkaline type of secretion, which is high in bicarbonate, and that buffers the acidity of the chyme, and it makes it where it's neutral, and then all the pancreatic enzymes can work properly. And those are enzymes that are made to chemically digest the carbohydrates, fats, and proteins and break them down into sugars, fatty acids, and amino acids. The pancreas also functions as an exocrine gland and an endocrine gland. So the exocrine portion, so I was gonna say this is not really right here. So the exocrine portion is this right here, this production of the digestive enzymes that are released into the gut tube. The endocrine function of the pancreas is it also produces hormones that are insulin and glucagon, which help to regulate blood glucose levels. And I will have the lesson on the endocrine system coming up later. But insulin will help get glucose from the bloodstream into the cell. So when your blood glucose is high, it lowers it. And glucagon kicks in to release stored glucose from the liver when your blood sugar is low, so maybe when you're in a fasted state. So the pancreas makes these two hormones that are, of course, important also because they regulate glucose. And so, sorry about that. That's the last slide, and that is your review of the digestive system.